हेलो, गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। सो वी शैल वेट फॉर 1 मिनट। Let people join in and then we will start. Yes, so we have people joining in, and in few seconds we will start with the session. Thank you, ladies, for joining in so fast. Hi, Urvashi. Hi, Priya. Hi, Jyoti. Okay, I think we are good to go. Many people have joined in, and people will come as we start the session. So, a very good evening to all the lovely ladies. Today, we are back with one more power-packed interview on our employment series segment with a power guest speaker. We have started this segment under Skill Connect and Skillets Foundation with the intention to give insights into the employment scenario, what are the opportunities for freshers, or to the women, especially who want to start their second innings, or even to those who want to go ahead in their careers. For such awareness, we call people from different fields to gain perspective of diverse sectors. Even though we may be very good in technical knowledge, but if we are not able to portray it or brand ourselves in front of people, then we may be losing something very important, or we may not stand out from the crowd. This is one area where every one of us needs attention and an understanding. So, what is that one thing which makes you visible from rest of the world, which makes you stand out from the rest of the crowd? Any guesses? Okay, so I will tell you, and you, many of you must have guessed it right. It is soft skill, our image, our attitude, and much more. I'm very happy today that we have an expert who is going to share with us that one skill and how and when we can use it for our advantage. Let us welcome Monali Thakur. I will bring her on the screen. Hello, Monali. How are you?
Hello, good evening,
Good
Sonali
evening.
ma'am. I'm great. Thank you so much.
Good evening. So, Monali, on behalf of Skill Connect and Skillets Foundation, I welcome you to this platform, and it is our privilege to have you with us today. So before we start the session, I want to give a quick introduction about you. Monali is a soft skill trainer and co-founder at EdPresence. She's an empanel trainer at various institutes like ICAI, Image Consulting Business Institute, PeopleCraft Training Solutions Limited. She's also an educator in schools across the country. Her clients include Tata Motors Pune, VP Tucker and Company, ICAI, Enhanced Skill Training Solutions, Nirma University, Skillsor at Task Initiatives Limited, Polycab India Limited, and the list is very long, so I'll just say to name a few. So I'm so glad that we have such a versatile personality with us today. Monali, we are really privileged to have you here and welcome once again.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It's an honor for me as well. And I know we've been connecting since so long now, and finally the day has come. So yes. I'm more than happy to be here.
Yes.
And that was Monali, quite a nice introduction. I mean, very deep introduction, I would say. A very detailed one.
Thank you. Monali, shall we start then?
Yes, please. Yes, I'm all set.
Yes. So, I mean, after going through your profile and everything, I was so elated that finally you are here and we have a guest speaker like you on our platform. So, by reading through Facebook and everything, I could know that you're professional. But who is Monali? What is your, can you share your personal journey with us?
Oh, sure. Yes, it's been quite a roller coaster ride for me, but I would really love to share my story. So basically, I belong to Mumbai. I've been born and brought up there, and I did my education in Mumbai. And I got married at a very early age. So at 22, I was married, and my husband happens to be an army officer. And I was very happy to get married then also. But one thing kept me always thinking that I have to still go ahead with my education, and I did not want it to stop. So yeah. The biggest support was actually my husband, because he never stopped me from pursuing whatever I wanted to do even after marriage. So my actual journey, I would say, started after I became a mother. It was only after my daughter was born, I gave her a lot of time to raise her. And that's when, you know, my husband told me that now is the time you should also start doing something what you want to do. So she was a great child, very cooperative and very understanding. And because of her and my wonderful family, I could manage to pursue something that I always wanted to. So I was very passionate about being a teacher. And the best part, being an army wife, I could travel across the country with my husband, and a school was always there. I may not find corporates, or I may not find bigger MNCs everywhere, but a school would definitely be there with a lot of students. So I chose to become a teacher because of that. And after I pursued my BEd from Mumbai, I started working. I did one job in Mumbai, of course, and then I moved to Northeast, and then to North, and then South, and everywhere across the country. So more than a decade, I was teaching in various schools. Thereafter, in 2016, actually, that was a time when my daughter was also grown up. I was a principal of a preschool in Jaipur, and that's where I came in the training mode, because I used to, you know, ensure that my staff is well groomed, and I started taking up smaller trainings, and I realized that yes, I can do this. And there were some people around me, you know, who told me that, why don't you take it up as a, you know, profession, a full-time profession into training. So I did a certification from Image Consulting Business Institute in soft skills, and I became a certified trainer. So since 2016, 17 almost, I started training. Before that, I also did my post-graduation in human resource management. So I used to always keep doing something or the other to upgrade myself whenever my husband used to take off in his field location, and I was all alone with my daughter. So I used to make use of that time, because I feel as women, you know, we need to be very strong, and we should make the most of it in whichever conditions or whatever challenges we have. So that was one thing which I always followed, not to give a break anywhere in between in my CV, yeah. Where what was I doing for that 1 year? So I was always up to something or the other. And yeah, so after I became a trainer, I think I just thought, let me try. A lot of people told me, you know, it's not so easy. It's a different world. It will be very difficult. You come from a teaching, school teaching background. Who's going to accept you as a trainer? But then, yeah, I took my baby steps, and I feel at that level of a learner where I'm still taking my baby steps. But I think I met a lot of great people, a lot of great mentors, and got wonderful opportunities to start with. So that got me here today, and I'm so
Wow.
happy.
What an inspirational journey, Monali. I mean, I'm really impressed. Chatting with you now and interacting with you, and also looking at your profile and everything. So I think what you are speaking actually resonates with our objective of forming the Skillets Foundation. Because here what we do is we train all the entrepreneurs and the ladies, basically women from urban as well as rural areas. So we give them opportunity to or we skill them so that they can stand on their own feet, they can become financially independent. And I think that is most important thing to empower a woman. And I think that is why we connected so well, because objectives are same.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So Monali, like we always have that feeling in mind that you know that we have technical knowledge, and I have come first class, or I have passed with distinction. And there are a lot of students, like I also interact with many students, and they are least bothered, or parents as such are also not bothered actually that okay, my son, my daughter, or they have come first, and now they can excel. But the hard part is, difficult part is when they actually go out after completing their education and they want to go for the job or whatever it is, but then they actually they don't get the job, or everyone doesn't get the dream job. So that is where that training part comes. So really it is very important. I mean, you can throw more light on it, that even though a person having technical knowledge, but if you are not able to portray yourself well before employers or people, then you fail. So how training is important to excel in careers?
Wonderful question, Sonali ma'am. So yes, this is a challenge not only in today's time. I think it has always been a challenge for so many years now. We have also been in that generation where degrees were only important, and a lot of people used to not, in fact, even think about these skills, which are considered more when it comes to an interview. So they say that 85% they look at your soft skills, and 15% is only the hard skills actually count as per the survey, right? That's how the facts say. But then what happens is whatever has been ingrained into us since the beginning is just run after degrees, just make sure that you enter into a good college and get a great job and get good salary, so that is the only thing people look at, and they forget that to enter into that dream job you need to be knowing your soft skills, right? So I think it has to start from the beginning. It has to start from the schools, and I would say that now things have started changing. People have started realizing this, and the curriculum is set in a way where they have started inculcating all these aspects of soft skills also in the school curriculum. I am myself working with a school, in fact, as a project we are doing it with them, wherein they are teaching 10th, 11th, 10th, 12th standard students how to be good at public speaking, how to be good at group discussions, how to be good in their appearance and all that. So I think I'm just talking about one school. I'm sure there are many other schools who are even thinking about it. So for people who are still feeling that they can achieve it with the number of degrees that they have, then they are yet to catch up because the bus is going to leave, right? It's very sure that you may be very good at technical skills, but when it comes to a crisis moment, I think your basic skills of your values, your team building skills, your leadership skills, all these really matter, right? And soft skills, as in your overall communication, matters the most. So it's not about the language that you speak. You may not be very fluent in English, it doesn't really matter, but how you communicate is more important. So are you able to convey your point in the right manner at the right time? That is what is the most important thing, which is not taught in textbooks, unfortunately.
Totally agree. And that is why I think the first instant when students get out of their education and the complete setup, college setup, and they face this corporate problems. So, and the corporates have also problems because they don't get any employees whom they can use from right from the first day, employee ready.
Yes.
So, but like Monali, you said that there are different education. There's system education system in our country is very complicated as such, and you know there are different specializations: marketing, finance, and HR is there. Then operations. So all these specializations are there. Then along with it, there are different sectors also. So IT sector, then banking sector, financial sector. So, I just want to understand, and this has been the question since so long for me, that do the soft skills are same for all the sectors or do they vary? I mean, this is what I always wanted to know, and I think you are the best person.
Yes, absolutely. So what happens is, even if for example, just a hypothetical example I'm giving, if I'm doing a job which is very technical in nature, like from 9 to 5, I'm very clear that I have to sit in front of the computer and just type in and get things in place and send emails and a lot of data to be handled, right? But at the end of it, I'm still going to report to somebody, or I'm going to take a report from somebody, depending on the designation that I hold, how much of a technical job that you're doing. So your soft skills would matter then, whether how are you able to take people's suggestions, people's complaints, and are you able to empathize with them? Are you able to understand them well? Your language, your body language also would matter. So it's not only the words at times that we speak as whatever designation you're holding. It's also your overall conduct, your behavior. So your soft skills, your etiquette will come in picture then, because your presence will make a difference. It's not about somebody sitting there and working and completing the work. What is the impact that you're leaving on people? Are you making them feel inspired? Are you helping them out? Are you showing that the real time comes when there is any crisis moment, anything goes wrong, and what is the step that you take in that moment is the most important. So I think for that, we do need to go through all these skills in which we learn the basics of communicating with people. And that is what is the most important.
Yes, I know. I mean, skill management, when to use what skill, where, what time. So I think that makes a lot of difference, and that is what we don't teach our children, right?
True.
So what are the specific skills that you look for while recruiting people? Or you are now attached to so many corporates also, and what do they look for?
Great. So, a lot of times it's a myth that they say that you have to create a great, impactful first impression on people. Okay, that is what they tell each and every candidate before they go for the interview. But let me tell you, it's not only the first impression that matters, because people on the other side are definitely experts. The panel members, whoever have been appointed, are appointed for a reason. So they definitely know the profile of the candidate looking at the resume that they have sent. It's not that they are going to ask each and everything to the candidate in the interview. What they are actually looking at is your presence, is again, your body language, the impression that you create, whether it is genuine or not, they come to know. So it is not important that on that one particular day you dress the best, you put your best foot forward, you perform the best. It is not important like that. They are not looking for that. They want the same kind of attitude on an everyday basis. It can get better, definitely, but not the other way around. So when people go with a mindset that, okay, let me create a great impression today and I will get selected, they may get selected also for some reason, but then it is a major put off for the employers when they actually see the true colors which come out in a very short time of period, right? So I think that has to be taken into consideration, that whenever you have to go for an interview, you have to definitely create a good impression, but I think it should be a long-lasting impression that will make a lot of difference.
So Punali, then what इज सोशल मीडिया वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट? और द सोशल मीडिया प्रेजेंस लाइक यू नो फेसबुक और द लिंक्डइन प्रोफाइल्स, और सो आर दे ऑल्सो इम्पोर्टेंट? डू रियली एम्प्लॉयर्स लुक फॉर ऑल दीज प्रोफाइल्स फॉर द
Yes,
एट द टाइम ऑफ रिक्रूटमेंट?
yes, and in today's time they do see with the job description that they give. Definitely the candidates do look at the job description and they apply for it, and they
Correct.
read the interview, right? But in that time between the application and the real time interview, the HR team definitely looks into their social media handles. And now that so many people are already there on social media, so one tip I can give here is it is very important to keep a balance in what you are actually as a person with your professional and your personal life. Because a lot of people get mixed up. So, for example, I see a lot of professionals who are probably dealing into something else as per their profession, but then talking about anything and everything on social media. So there's a lot of confusion around it, that what exactly are you opinionating about, which side you are on. So it gets a little complicated. So ideally, if you think that you have want to give your views or you have some opinions about certain issues in the society, then probably you can have a separate account made, or you can be a blogger or an influencer as a different name, but not confuse it with your professional profile that you have already created on LinkedIn, or for that matter Facebook, Instagram also. So not necessary that one has to be on social media. There are still a lot of people, Sonali ma'am, who do not believe, especially people who are super introverts, they don't want to be on social media, which is also okay. But I think at least they should be aware of what is happening. Even without being on social media, it is possible by a lot of reading that they can do on blogs or something like that. But totally being unaware would be a little, difficult, I would say.
So social media also plays a very important role
It
in
does.
understanding one's image, right?
It
And
does.
I really liked what you said, that what you are as a person or what you put up on the social media, Facebook, so there should not be any contradictions. So it implies that you are a kind of a different or split personality. So
Exactly.
one person or one personality saying something, one image, and another saying some. So conflicting images or conflicting ideas should not be there.
Yes.
So I think that is very important point for not only for students or freshers or youngsters, for us also, I guess, because when you look at the profile of people or this thing, and people do look at your profile on Facebook or social media. So it should not be conflicting posts or something like that, what you are not. Totally, totally agree with you. Are there any specific skills or specific trends which are coming up in terms of skills? Because every day there is some new change which is happening. And would you like to throw or give us some specific skills which are very new to us and we don't know?
Okay, I'm sure I won't be probably telling you totally something new, but I'm sure that today's time, I think virtual etiquette is something which I feel is the most important, because I've been
Yes,
dealing
virtual
with
etiquette. I wanted
virtual
to have
etiquette.
that word.
Yes,
Yes.
because it's not only with students that I work with so many people from different professions, from different backgrounds for trainings. And one thing I realize, it may be just a meeting, right? But the way you dress up, or the way you again present yourself on a virtual platform, is the need of the hour. One should catch up with it. One should learn it. I see a lot of people when the cameras are on, they are attending probably a business meeting or something, which is an important meeting. But then people take a chance to get up from their place, look for their chargers, or maybe they look for things which are missing. So that shows, that actually talks about their personality, that they are ill-organized, right? I mean, one has to be organized, right, as much as possible. So there can be mistakes I totally agree. But then you can't repeat mistakes. I feel we should all learn from our mistakes. We should revisit our virtual presence. How did we come across on the camera and learn from it? I think we are our best teachers, and we should look at ourselves and think, okay, what is wrong? What can be better? And then work on it. That's what I do. I mean, we all, it was especially when the COVID era started, this was all new, right? Nobody was very much used to it, but we all learned from it. We all made mistakes, but we have to learn from it. A lot of people give up at a point of time, right? So in today's time, if you ask me, the trend is to be very well-versed with the platforms. Like today we are using StreamYard. There is Microsoft Teams, there is Google Meet, there is Zoom. Zoom is very user-friendly though, right? So there are many other such platforms. There is something called as BlueJeans, I came to know. And so you know, so one has to be up and about all these recent platforms, so that once in a while also, if you have to suddenly go, you should not be looking for the tools on the screen, what to do where. Yeah, so we should do a little tech walk beforehand where we are very clear. So that's the need of the hour in today's time. Let us all get used to the new normal and let's be best at it. I think that's what I feel is the trend. And still show up,
Digital.
dress up and show up. Should never go, you know, it should be still
Yes. Yeah. I mean, you should dress up as if you are going for a office, going to office or business meeting like that. So even though you have to sit in front of camera, but still it has to be like you're going out.
Right.
So,
I tried it once, you know. I remember I tried it once where I tried with the pajamas and a formal shirt and a scarf. And that particular day, I didn't feel myself like a trainer. So I felt, no, there's something wrong with me. How can I train on etiquette and grooming like this? So I make sure that every time I dress up, I try, you know, as much as possible. Obviously, I remember the first 2 months I was even wearing my shoes, you know, formal shoes. So after a while, then I realized it's really not required. So yeah, we can be in our own comfort zones, but make sure that we are very well versed with the camera and how do we present ourselves. Because for online interviews also, Sonali ma'am, nowadays a lot of interviews are happening online. So people need to keep this in mind that the lighting is proper. They have to check their mics. This is the trend. I mean, they should be very well versed with the social media, reading a lot of blogs on social media, because today's generation, I see they hardly touch books, you know, to read the way we
I
used
know.
to. So at
Right,
least
right, right.
do not leave the habit of reading. I think reading will never go out of trend. One has to be a very well-read person and not only read just for the sake of it, but try to apply what you have read. That will actually make the difference in your personality.
Wow. Such an insight. I mean, digitally, yes, you have to be very well versed. Otherwise, you are outdated. You become irrelevant otherwise.
I would like to
So,
share one more story. A recently a friend
please.
of mine visited me from Ahmedabad, and she was talking about her aunt who lives in Pune, and she's 73 years old, believe you me, but she takes online sessions for meditation.
Wow.
So once I felt that, I mean, if I mean that age, one can be so outgoing. We are still like really young to catch up on so many things.
Definitely. I mean, many of people above 60 also, they are doing this yoga sessions specifically, and they are learning. So I think pandemic has really I mean, it was horrible and it is still going, but some things we have it has taught us, so that is going to stay with us forever. Monali, are there any different segments of soft skill? I mean, this question just came out of my mind that are there any segments, like we already know that soft skill, अच्छा ठीक है, soft skills है, and but we actually don't know inside soft skills what is the segregation, what are the segments, and which segment you like most to train or teach people?
Oh wow. So yeah, it's a very good question, very close to my heart, I must say, because this is one thing which every trainer must be having, I'm sure, you know, favorite topic types. So soft skills, if you ask me the segregation, there are many such topics where it starts from communication. Communication is the base of every topic in soft skills. So okay. If you keep communication as the base, of course, the verbal communication and the body language, keeping both in mind, then of course, if you talk about leadership skills, if you talk about team building, if you talk about conflict management, which is again a very important thing to understand, you know, emotional intelligence, I think that is also one topic which everyone should understand, and you know, that helps you to be very well connected with your own emotions and understand others' emotions also. So like kind of empathizing with people. And there is one topic called transactional analysis, which is again one of my favorite topics. It is basically related to the three ego states in which every human being is in. So parent ego state, child ego state, and adult ego state. These are the three states which every human being is in. So it's a very deep topic, and what I have realized is a lot of people do not know about this topic also. I generally ask, you know, in the initial ice breaking, what do you think this topic is about? So just the name tells them that, you know, the literal meaning, it should be something about some transactions, you know. So it's not the real time we sign. It's about real human being nature. Okay, so it's very important for everyone to know, and people should explore more in this topic. Apart from this, of course, there is etiquette, there is grooming, there is dining etiquette, and there's so many such things. And appearance, your overall appearance management. So when you ask me that question about what recruiters look into you, this is one part, is your appearance, which you have to take care of. And like I said, it has to be very genuine, and you should look your part. That's more important. If you're playing a role of a teacher, then you have to make sure that you look like a teacher. If you're playing a role of a, you know, the other day, I remember I went to a salon. They just asked me, are you a doctor? So I said, how could you make out I'm a doctor? So, you know, sometimes people, they look at you and they make their own judgments. Yeah. You can't stop them, right? So I had to literally no, I'm not a doctor. So you have to sometimes you have to ensure that you look your part. So probably I was dressed too formally for a salon. That's why they probably looked at me and asked me, am I a doctor or something? Anyway, so yeah, these are all the topics. And my favorite topic, I would say, is always etiquette and grooming, because I feel there are so many takeaways, whichever audience I deal with, be it students, be it younger students, be it adult students, be it employees of organizations, be it women. You know, there are different categories into etiquette, and I go very deep when I take these sessions, talking about etiquette. And grooming, of course, is one of my favorites too. So yeah, wow. I think that's my favorite topic.
Wow. Yeah. So nice. I mean, transactional analysis. So this was the value addition for me. I did not know this. Munali, there are many women here. I mean, this is a women's group, but then generally it has been noticed that, you know, there are many women have lost their jobs, or they have taken a break and then they want to start again. So are there any specific skills which employers would be looking in them? Because then there was a break in their career and now they are again starting. But I know companies are recruiting, like Credit Suisse, where I have worked. So they are again recruiting the people from, you know, who used to work for them, and they are recruiting. But then there is a gap. So what kind of skills the employers really look for the second innings, we should say?
So I feel one has to be, again, very genuine and not fake it. I think every woman should take it as a pride that she has taken a break for her family, which is a great thing to do. I think to raise a child or to give some time to yourself also, or to upgrade yourself at times, you take a break. So sabbatical can be for many reasons, not only related to a pregnancy or becoming a mother. It can be even for learning something new or exploring something totally new, which you have not done. So I think employers also look at your overall attitude in life. it's not only they ask you that what did you do in break, that doesn't mean that even if you've not done anything, it is absolutely okay. But you may probably say that how did you use that time more productively? So maybe even okay. if you've given some time to read some really good books on self-development, if you've given yourself some time on fitness, if you've given yourself some time to learn some new course, I think that is okay. It's just that you are not getting some salary for a while. And yeah. one has to be very, you know, true about it. In fact, I have also come across a lot of women who ask me that what should we do that we can't say that we were on a break. And this is what I tell them. It is okay to say that we were on a break and
this
we were
is
doing
a very important point.
Instead of
yes.
faking it, because then I think that's wrong to fake
they
it.
They know that you are faking
they
it.
They understand, absolutely. But take it as a pride that you gave time to your family and there is nothing wrong in it. I think as women, we all have to go through all this, that we have to look after. Nowadays, even men help so much.
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen so many families in which it's a joint, you know, effort.
Yeah, joint venture.
Yeah, joint venture. Yeah, it's a joint effort of the parents. So, yeah, I think it just works. You need to talk it out. You need to...
Right.
It's very important to be understanding and help each other out. And there you are. You can still do it. So like I told you, my journey started after I became a mother. So I never gave up. So don't give up. Yes, never give up.
Right. So I think that is a really a good and inspirational point that you have made here, that a woman should not fake anything. If you're applying for the second innings or you want to even start the business after you become mother or after when, I mean, you are 50, 45. So there should be a kind of honesty and sincerity in whatever you are doing or projecting. So I think employers get, they get impressed with all these things and they also look for the sincere and honest people.
Yes.
Yeah. So it is very, so I think that everyone should understand that there is not a break as such in your life, but you are just taking it easy or learning new things and then you are coming back or bouncing back again. So
and
that was
one
really
thing I would like to add is, because when you see a job description and go, and whatever point of time, even it is after sabbatical, you have to be professionally very competent at that job. That is
right.
what they're looking for. See, if you say that just because I was in a break, I'm not able to understand what's about anything in my field, that is a big put off. So even if
that cannot be,
that cannot be an excuse. So one has to be professionally very competent enough for the job that they have applied
right.
for. I think that
right.
counts.
Yeah. So you have to be competent, updated, and honest as well. That's why you have taken the break. Right?
Yes.
Wow. So great. We have many women entrepreneurs in the group, and also like when we were chatting, when we were talking before the interview, I shared with you that we are doing skilling for entrepreneurs. We are trying to give them financial help and making them stand on their feet. So are there any specific skills for entrepreneurs as such, or the skills that we say or we have for the employees? So are they same, or entrepreneurs need something different from the people who are looking for the job?
So ma'am, again, I see a lot of Facebook pages nowadays created by entrepreneurs. Like, they feel that they can at least start small. Okay, the visibility is very important for all the entrepreneurs. There is for visibility, you can use a social media platform. Your contacts, it can be you know, from your family, it can be from your family friends, whoever you know. Try to talk about your work. I think a lot of women have this hesitation of, you know, talking about what they do. I remember meeting a child and asking what does your mother do, and she was confused. What does her mother do? Right? What exactly does she do? So it's very important to, even to your close family members, they should be exactly knowing what kind of entrepreneur you are and what
yes.
your job like. So talk about it to people, talk about it on the social media, create Facebook pages, create Instagram. So nowadays when I even go on Instagram, I see a lot of young entrepreneurs, women entrepreneurs doing small things, but they have the way they put up pictures and they start getting inquiries of what they're doing, how they're doing. People want to learn from them. People want to buy their products. So there is a lot of scope because of social media to invest less money and still be there, yes. Right? So one needs to be updated. One needs to have a collaborative mindset as an entrepreneur also. So once
yes.
you start your new journey, I think a lot of people will come to you to collaborate, to learn from you or to do something together. One should be open for it, because if you're not ready to share your expertise or work with somebody, there may be ups and downs. There may be challenges. Sometimes it may just not work. But still, you have
right.
learned something in that journey, I feel, right? So you should take it on and just, I think, explore more opportunities like this, I feel. And be a part of so many platforms nowadays.
So many groups are there. Yes.
You must be a part of it so that you are aware of what's going on in your field also. So that's very important.
Actually, right? Yeah, actually you can do a PhD on the social media platform and the visibility. So that is also
yes.
a very important
yes.
topic. And like you said, that is what we have also, that collaborations, partnerships. I mean, this is the buzzword. Without that, you can go a little ahead, but not very high. So I think that is the most important thing that you have said. Collaborations, partnerships are must for entrepreneurs at any level, I guess. Even
yes.
even if you have started or you have to a certain stage, but you cannot be an expert in everything. So you
right.
have to have the partners who can take care of certain things and you take care of. So
yes, and
that
I
is also
that
good.
One skill which you are good at, you need to constantly work on it, and you that's why you're called an expert, because it's not that you want to be jack of all and master of none. Then
yeah.
It is again very confusing. So a very few people I've seen that who can be everywhere and doing still very great. Rather, I would feel that you should concentrate on one skill at a time and
right.
go deep into it to understand. Then only you can be called an expert in the
right,
field.
Right. Yes,
yeah.
yes, yes. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, because unless and until you are expert, then you cannot go ahead beyond a certain stage. That is what also I feel. So I mean, it was really great talking to you, Monali, but one last thing, what message you would like to give to women out there?
Okay, so I think we should just keep going, never give up. I think that's my motto, is never to give up and seek help, seek guidance. A lot of women I see, they feel that I don't want anybody's help. I can be on my own. I can do everything. So I somehow feel that I think it's okay to seek guidance. It's okay to have mentors. It's okay to
yeah.
fall, get up and get going, you know.
Yeah.
So the moment you, if you feel that you have not made it, try it one more time. And seeking guidance or help is, it shouldn't be below your dignity. I think
yeah.
Learn better like that from, because people who will guide you or mentor you, they might also have done some mistakes, and they will talk about their mistakes to you, which you can avoid, right?
Yeah.
Rather than doing
yes.
it. So I think I always feel like yesterday was Guru Purnima, and I ensure that I message all my mentors and my, you know,
yes.
in my life who really helped me to be
yeah.
At this stage today. Right? So
yes,
please seek guidance at whatever level you are, whatever age you are. We all need gurus. So
right.
I think there should be somebody whom we look up to and take support. That's perfectly okay. I think I love to take support. It's okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I give the credit to the people who give support to me too.
Yes.
And that's because of my family, because of my friends or my mentors. I think I give
yeah.
the credit to all of them.
Absolutely. I mean, life is really simple, but we ourselves make it complicated.
Yes.
Yes, so
Again,
very.
I forgot to mention about the journey of Ed Presence in my journey. So how Ed Presence started also was just like this. It was just because of the collaborative mindset came very later. It was just about seeking help from each other first, and that's how we clicked, and we thought that let's do something new, and it's okay. So we are also learning. We are also It's a fantastic platform where we are coming in front of people and getting some guest speakers also, and trying to help people out there. So we trainers, educators, students. So I think Ed Presence is also something where we are trying to help people, empower people, right? So I think we all are in the same journey. It's just that we need to keep constantly, I would say, upgrading ourselves and keep getting inspired by a lot of people around.
Yes, definitely. I mean, it was I just want or would love to keep on listening to you, Monali, and our thoughts, our ideas, they resonate so well together. I mean, whatever you were sharing, we also at Skillets Foundation, so we are five directors, and everyone comes from a diverse background, but still we are together because of the common objective. And I think that is the beauty that you are diverse, but then the objective is same. So that makes it wonderful team. So I would we would really love to have you as our collaborator, and we would love to work together. This is what I
Thank
want
you
to.
so much. Thank you
Yes,
so
I mean
much.
So thank you again, Monali, for sparing your valuable time and sharing your journey, your tips, and you are an inspiration to others. Thank you so much.
Thank you
Thank
so much.
you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm glad to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you. So, friends, this was again a power-packed session on employability series. And next Saturday, we would again come back with another person and another session. Till then, goodbye. Take care. Thank you.